think I read Ms. Linder's there were probably others, but those were the three that I recall.
And it's your recollection that somewhere in all those depositions and perhaps others, you read somewhere there were records belonging to the papers?
Yes.
Do you know in fact that what was described were some canceled checks?
I don't recall that specifically, but it is my understanding that there may have been canceled checks among the records. Yes.
And you don't really know anything else about any specific types of records beyond the mentioned canceled checks, correct?
I didn't believe that it was necessary or germane.
Yes
to
or no? Do you have additional information about the nature of those records other than a specific description of they were canceled checks?
Well, I don't even know that they were the canceled checks.
Okay, so you don't know what they were.
All I know is that there was a description of them in some of the depositions.
There was a description in some of the depositions to the effect that there may have been some canceled checks that wasn't going to be there. Is that it?
Yes.
Okay. Other than that, you don't have any recollection?
I don't have any recollection.
Now, you read the documents that are in the chain title concerning property related.
Chain of title meaning from the time the Abrams owned it?
Well, from even before. Well, if you looked at Mr. Gravis's report, he sort of went into the predecessors entitled eventually the Abrams purchased the property from the HOLC Corporation.
Right. I didn't go beyond the what in essence was a foreclosure in 1934 when the Abrams acquired the property.
Well, in fact, the Abrams acquired title of the property in 1934.
I'm sorry, I reversed the numbers.
Okay, that's fine. And from what you can tell, the chain of title from, correct, please correct me if I'm wrong, from 1943, when Lewis and Estella Abrams purchased the property from the HOLC Corporation up until, I believe, 1958, title vested in Lewis Abrams and his wife Estella.
That is correct, except that I don't remember when Lewis Abrams died, because title obviously passed to his wife at his passing.
That's right. So if Mr. Abrams passed in 1955, at that point in time, because they were tenants like entirely in the custody of the wife, and so designated on the deed, and they're not going to have additional agreements as to joint tenancies or anything like that, title would have been passed to Mrs. Abrams.
That is correct.
And then looking again at the documents in the chain of title, you see that in 1958, Estella conveys the property from herself solely to herself and her daughter.
Correct.
And that's 1958.
I believe so.
Okay. And then subsequently in 1965, because Estella, her Estella has passed, Anna herself,
that's my understanding.
And title to the property doesn't pass again from 1965 until 2006.
But believe
me. By way of a deed.
Yes, by way of deed it doesn't pass, but it did pass by virtue of three Palmer deaths.
All right. Let's put that to the side. In all of that history, do you have any indication at all that the Palmers and Ann Abrams may or may not have any agreement regarding a safe or any other personal items that may have been in 1602
for them? I didn't see any testimony in this particular case that I reviewed that indicated one way or the other.
So, I mean, granted, anything is possible, but there's nothing in the available record that permanently that they never negotiated for, if the safe had been in the property before the Palmers purchased it, that maybe they were going to leave. There's nothing to say that that didn't happen.
That is correct. it would be speculative on my part to decide whether that was true or wasn't true. I have no idea, no way of knowing.
Okay. And we have no way of knowing who, in fact, lo those many years ago, took that box in the hidden compartment with the certificates hidden away in the false bottom and put it in that safe.
I saw nothing in any of the records that indicated it one way or the other.
So other than knowing that at some point in time, some documents that bore the name Lewis Abrams and Son canceled checks were in that safe, there's nothing else that confers ownership of the gold certificates upon Abrams.
Just the proximity of the certificates and the checks would lead me to believe that they were one and the same. But your premise is correct. I saw nothing in any of the facts of this case.
Now, you were asked by Mr. Benedict his personal property.
Yes. Yes.
And then you were also asked with regard to a finder of the property.
Yes.
Okay. And I believe you also referred to a statute.
I did.
Okay. If I'm not mistaken, that statute is in Title 46, which concerns real property.
It's 46:30, capital C.
Okay. And did you recognize this book?
Oh, yes.
With it?
Oh, yes.
For the jury?
We don't see that book very much anymore because everything is online, but as an older practitioner, I've handled those books for many years.
As have I. And this is the Jersey statute's annotated?
Yes.
Okay. So the statute in question is entitled Lost or Abandoned Property. And there's 46-30C-1, or 46:30, capital C-1, is called the definition section, correct?
Correct.
All right. And there's three definitions.
I know there is at least one definition is finder.
Okay, all right. And that's in subsection C.
Correct.
Now, subsection A.
Yes.
Which believe me when I told you would define abandoned property.
Probably.
Okay, all right, probably. What would you like to take a look?
Sure.
Just take a look at subsection A.
Okay.
All right, there's a definition of abandoned property there?
Yes.
And in fact, it says property, abandoned property, and it's in quotation marks, is property of which the owner has intentionally given up possession under circumstances evincing intent to give up ownership.
That's what it says.
Okay. Subsection B addresses lost property.
Correct.
Okay. Would you agree with me that the definition of lost property is contained in the statute? Is property the possession of which has been parted with casually, involuntarily, or unintentionally, or which has been mislaid, left, or forgotten?
I agree with you wholeheartedly with that.
Okay. So the property that has been mislaid, left, or forgotten is subsumed within the definition of lost property.
Correct.
And then finally, subsection C, as you've indicated, refers to a finder, and it defines a finder as a person who acquires legal possession by exercising physical control over abandoned or lost property.
That is also correct.
Okay. Moving on, NJSA 46:30C-2. Helpfully enough, entitled Finder of Abandoned Property, Ownership.
And we're talking about abandoned property now.
Abandoned property, and it says a finder of abandoned property may assume ownership of it.
Correct.
Okay.
Sir, could you please take your hand down before
I can... I'm sorry. I'm very sorry.
So, in 46:30C-3, that subsection is entitled Finder, semicolon, reasonable efforts to return.
Yes.
Are you familiar with that?
Yes.
Okay. And it says, would you agree with me, to the owner or person in charge of the premises where the property was found, that's subsection B, or C, delivery to the local police or to a lost and found facility for the premises where the property is found.
You read it correctly.
Okay. And then in 46:30C-4, we come to another chapter or subsection entitled Claiming Lost Property.
Okay.
Well, do you want to take a look?
No, go ahead.
Okay. It says in subsection A, a person may claim lost property only after making reasonable efforts to return the property to its owner. You agree?
That's what it says.
And subsection D, the owner of the lost property does not reclaim it within 120 days of the commencement of reasonable efforts to return it. One, the owner of the premises where the property was found may claim title to buried or hidden lost property, or to lost property which a trespasser found. Or two, the finder of the property may claim title to lost property in other cases.
In other cases. That's what it says.
It says the finder of the property may claim title to lost property in other cases. And that would be cases other than which somebody doesn't make a claim within 120 days, and also in which the owner of the premises doesn't make a claim. Is that correct?
You read the statute.
Okay, but that is
that's correct. The statute.
Okay. So in your report,
I think you're looking at what says response to question number 6 incorrectly stated as number 4.
That is in fact what I'm looking at.
That's what I thought.
Okay.
Okay. And what was that again? Sorry.
It's the portion of
question number 6 incorrectly stated
response to question number.
Got it. Okay, thank you.
Right. So you're saying here a fighter is a person who acquires legal possession by exercising control over abandoned or lost property. And you quote the section of the statute that defines lost property as property the possession of which has been acquired casually, involuntarily, or unintentionally, or and you've emphasized, which has been mislaid, left, or forgotten. And that actually you said emphasis applied, but in the statute it's not under.
Well, that's my emphasis.
Correct. And then you go on to say, under the circumstances expressed above, the only logical conclusion to be reached is that the Abrams family left or forgot about the gold certificates. Now, if that were true, that would render it lost property, not abandoned property.
Correct.
So, when you conclude that Schaefer is the owner, or as the finder of the property became the owner, that's not exactly true, because it wasn't abandoned. It was lost.
It was lost property.
And I believe you asked, you were asked whether or not, in your opinion, personal property that was in the home at the time title passed from Lisa Linder as the administrator of the grandmother's estate to the entity formed by the Burks. You indicated that it did not pass by way of deed.
It did not pass specifically by way of deed. That's correct.
But there's nothing to indicate that it didn't actually pass by actual fact. Outside.
That would be something you'd have to have testimony on to prove.
Okay. Right. So, as you already indicated, personal property can pass by way of an oral agreement. It's not necessary to pass ownership or ownership interest or claim of right or whatever
two parties frequently have different intent on what they're planning on doing. So the oral agreement is always a dangerous agreement because one party may think that they're doing one thing and the other party may think they're doing something else.
Absolutely, but then you can also look at how the parties are behaving with respect to the items in question.
That is correct, and as I previously testified, Mr. Schaefer was told to get rid of the junk by Ms. Linder.
Right, but when the title to the house passed, whatever oral agreement there was regarding personal property,
no, not necessarily. It would depend upon what the oral agreement was. I've had agreements where they survived the passing of the real estate title.
That's fine. What we know is that the contract of sale called for the property to be left in clean condition.
That is correct.
What we know is that there are may have been an agreement or a tolerance on the part of Ms. Linder that Keith Schaefer could contain certain items in the house.
I'm not sure I understand that question.
Would it help to have it read back?
Well, sure.
Read the question back.
What we know is that there may have been an agreement or a tolerance on the part of Ms. Linder that Keith Schaefer could retain certain items in the house.
Well, as I previously indicated, the only thing I understood was that Ms. Linder told Mr. Schaefer to get rid of all the junk other than, and then the only thing I recall specifically was the Michael Jackson doll.
Right, so you didn't read Lisa Linder's statement to the police, correct?
I may have, but I don't recall.
Fagen, any questions?
Is there anything in any deed or contract from Abrams to Palmer indicating any transfer of a safe?
I didn't see anything in any of the testimony that I read or reviewed.
So is it fair to say that the only time there was any knowledge for what you reviewed of a safe was when Mr. Schaefer bookcased the safe? Would that be fair to say?
Correct. Certainly, if I'm going to receive something like a safe, I would know that I'm not open.
Response to question six, incorrectly stated happened here is I asked you hypothetical questions, and you provided your answers.
I did. That's correct.
I do the assumptions, and you read part of the last sentence. Do you have that for you?
Bear with me. Yes, sir. I have it now.
And you described lost property, correct? The second, the last sentence in the paragraph.
Yes.
And then you read the part that says, under the circumstances expressed above, the only logical conclusion to be reached is that the Abrams family left and forgot about the false certificates. Did you read that part?
I read that, yes.
The sentence actually continues and Schaefer is the finder of the property became the owner.
Correct.
Is there anything in the questions that the prosecutor asked you about Patent 4630C that changes your opinion?
Not at all. Wacks, thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you.